L'Evangelii Gaudium possiamo dire che è l'esortazione apostolica di Papa Francesco, forse ne rappresenta un po' il manifesto, no? Di quello che della lettura del Papa e dell'invito del Papa alla sua Chiesa. Ne parleremo oggi con grandi visioni, grandi prospettive. Per un aspetto parleremo dell'Italia, del nostro paese, l'Evangelii Gaudium e le sfide dall'America Latina all'Italia, e l'altro aspetto che affronteremo è quello dell'America Latina. Che cosa chiede il Papa?
What the Pope is asking of our church. I don't want to interpret this, I just want to cite the passages of Evangelii Gaudium and what we have decided on the other topics. I would like to focus on the following issues: the reform of the Church and its missionary activity. In the words of Pope Francis, this affects all of us in reading this first chapter, because the key issue is, I dream of a missionary choice which will transform everything. I think that the Pope's invitation is to say everything that the Church is, everything that I am and that we are, for the target of the mission, for the Annunciation. Everything we are is here for this, and in the light of this, we have a request on the to the Church to resume and to further its knowledge of itself and to renew its place in the world and its encounter with men. So we will talk about this exhortation today with two illustrious guests and two friends of the meeting: His Eminence Cardinal Gualtiero Bassetti, the Archbishop of Perugia, and Vice President of the Italian Episcopal Conference, and on my left, Professor Guzmán, who is Secretary of the Vice Presidency, and this expression in itself tells us much about the Papal Commission for Latin America. Guzmán Carriquiry is a person who has spent his life in the service of the Church, and in particular of the Holy See. He has worked for many years in the Papal Council for Lay Faithful, embellishing the faith opened by Pope John Paul II to the lay movements within the Church. So I'd like to thank him again for coming here today. He is not new to the meeting, because he has often participated in other editions. So now I would like to ask His Eminence Cardinal Bassetti to introduce us to the reading of Pope Francis' Evangelii Gaudium. If you'd prefer to go to the podium, thank you. My warm greetings to all of you, starting from those I know from the excellencies present today, my brother bishops, the clergy. I see representatives from Florence, Arezzo, and Perugia. And this is a great pleasure for me, because it means that we have met and we have formed a friendship. And a warm embrace to all friends at the meeting who have invited me today to talk about today's topic. I'd like to start my talk with a citation from a book published in the 70s, Traces of and Experience of Human Experience, in which Don Giussani recounted his experience to young people. It was for man, man with his questions, his loneliness, his desires and his needs, which no one had ever been able to explain or resolve in full. For this man, a person lived who claimed to give himself to humanity as a whole in reply to their questions. This person is Jesus Christ, and Jesus Christ continues to live on. In these dear words, there lies the secret of the beginnings more than 50 years ago of what is your experience today. It is a story of encounters with man, a perspective open to the body of Christ, which has entered into our own story with his resurrection, and which has made the horizon of eternity and love something which is relevant today and can change our lives if we every day become free to welcome this message. Those who embrace this message will become the sons of God. My talk focuses on man, man for whom Christ was made flesh, and it could only be in this way because Pope Francis' Evangelii Gaudium is a reproposition of the Church's mission towards man as man appears from the look of God, from his unsuppressible needs for eternity, and as Pope Francis says strongly, his dignity which cannot be trodden down. Questions immediately arise. What is man? First of all, we must ask, which man must we move towards? Which men and which women does Francis' apostolic exhortation refer to? And this is a crucial question. The answer is simple but arduous. The existential and material peripheries, the Pope refers to our places inhabited by man just as he is in good and in evil, not in the abstract, not man as he ought to be. We do not need to seek the company of man as he ought to be, but men and women as they are, even when they do not share our views. In that man and in that woman, we must recognize without hypocrisy the signs of our dignity and our fragility, our greatness and our poverty, openness and closure. In this connection, we forgot too soon, and I would like to recall Pope Paul VI on the 7th of December 1965 ended the concilium with the words that merit reflection. I have meditated on these words, young people, and if you go and see how topical they are and how linked in they are with the thought of Pope Francis and help us to understand it. He said on that occasion, Pope Paul said, the Church and the Concilium has concerned itself with the relation linking God to man as he is today, man who is alive, who is concerned with himself, man who puts himself at the center of everything and dares to put himself as the reason for everything, man clothed in his many vestments and appearances, man who has stood up to the assembly of men, shepherds and brothers, loving and careful, but they also men, attentive to their own dramas, fragile and false. You can hear how modern this language is, how versatile, how ready to play any role. Let us look around us. A man who is rigid, who cultivates only science but a man who loves, who works, who always expects something. This is a holy man due to the innocence of his birth, due to the mystery of his poverty and the piety of his sorrow. The individualist, the asocial man, the humanist, profane man in the end has appeared in all his terrible stature and to some extent has challenged the church. I think these words are topical. The religion of God who became man has clashed with the religion of man who has made himself into God. And the Pope asks himself, this is a clash, a struggle, an anathema. This could have happened, but it didn't. The ancient story of the Good Samaritan was the paradigma of the spirit of the Concilium. And here we see how far Evangelii Gaudium dates back to Pope Paul VI in the Concilium, speaking of mercy and grasping the sign of the times, the old story of the Good Samaritan, which was the paradigm of the spirituality. The discovery of human needs has absorbed the attention of our synod. Man as he is, the phenomenic man, the only man who the Samaritan encounters. You cannot be surprised at the simplicity of this statement. We can illude ourselves that we can find man as he ought to be only by asking ourselves or closing ourselves within what the Pope calls laboratories by embracing the missionary mission, while man as he is the man, as Don Giussani said, is the man who has lived Jesus, claiming to give himself as an answer. Man as such has been accorded the fundamental mission of the rights and transcendent rights, his aspiration to dignity, to freedom, culture, and humanity have been, since the Council, purified and encouraged. In a word, transcendence of destinies is inseparable from the fullness of rights. It follows that Christ, as man's destiny, is testified by the ministry of our mission by following the road of liberation, pursuing dignity. In a word, if we move away from all this, we move away from our destiny, destiny with a capital D. Christ is not only on the horizon, but is also the confine of any ideological temptation or any fatalism. I think this also is very clear. The destiny of our neighbor is the destiny of our encounter with Christ. We cannot in any way turn the other cheek, and the teaching of the Matthew's Gospel, chapter 25. I gave you drink when you were thirsty. I clothed you when you were naked. I welcomed you when you were a stranger. Do not turn the other cheek. We will often have to accept the defeat of man, in particular the defeat of the poor. So in concrete terms, the defeat of the boats overturned in the Mediterranean, the overcrowded prisons in Italy, the projects of life and the lack of unemployment and jobs prevent personal realization. The bishops in Umbria issued a communique for the dramatic situation in our region of leading factories in Umbria, which is a small region and more at risk than others when these serious calamities come to pass. children who will never see the light of day, and children escaping hunger and war, women humiliated and overcome by violence and discrimination, and those who are forced to sell their own bodies for sexual purposes or even as incubators of human life. In inverted commas, this is not my expression. The defeat of the poor with the strength that comes from faith, that comes from the awareness that in the resurrection of Christ, every life is saved forever. This is the horizon, not only for our expectations, but above all for our commitment. And Don Mazzolari said that this is a horizon with no going back because it is in favor of man. Moreover, this is the victory which has defeated the world, our faith. So what challenges, after this premise, what are the challenges that the apostolic exhortation brings us to recognize in our society? First and foremost, I have repeated on many occasions, in this year, we need to acknowledge the awareness that we are living in an exceptional and very delicate period of history. We cannot move like elephants, like bulls in a china shop. We need to embrace the sign of the times. We need to be very careful and pay attention to the words of God, but also to realize the signs of the times. A historical moment characterized by cultural and geopolitical and economic revolutions which are redrawing the moral and cultural geography of the world. At the moment, certain challenges stem from Latin America and reach Italy and Europe in general. As you will see, this is something world-shattering and new. And I would like you to reflect on this. An epoch-making change made by Benedict XVI's statement, the fact that the Pope saw the end of the world, and on the threshold of St. Peter, we have a favored son of Latin American, a son of the continent of hope, as Pope John Paul defined it, a continent that was converted and evangelized by a mission as highlighted by Benedict XVI, and today, even with all its contradictions, its color and its poverty, with a Pope that comes from that world and presents himself to us with a great reason of hope. An announcement imbuing the indelible sign of Maria. Francis is not wrong to mention Maria three times a day and mentioning her religious spirit and the importance of this in Latin America. When I was vicariate in Florence, I went to Brazil, Bolivia, and Peru. It is important to take on this culture and to understand the indelible sign of Maria and the spiritual heritage of Our Lady of Parecida, an annunciation which, by her genetic profile, can only be joyful, maternal, wise, full of understanding for the young and for children, and lately characterized by sobriety, Jose Maria. In a sobriety that Europe seems to have lost in its lifestyle, in which human beings increasingly take on the semblance of an individual living for himself, dedicated to consumerism and enjoyment and the merchandise which is being produced ad infinitum. Europe is facing a crossroads, trying to find itself and to come out of the stagnation in which it is mired, or else to resign itself to an uncertain and marginal future. I have prayed about this before I came here to express these words. I came here with a series of questions because I don't want my talk to be simply abstract. What has remained today of the Europe of St. Paul, Paul of the three cultures, the Jew who spoke Greek, who was a Roman citizen, and the Europe of St. Augustine, the Latin African who was baptized in Milan by St. Ambrose on Easter night? What survives today of the Europe of the patron saints and the Benedictine monks? Go and look at a map of Europe in the first millennium. It was covered with Benedictine abbeys, and in the second millennium by Franciscan monasteries. Benedict and Francis lie in the roots of Europe. And in my small region of Italy, Umbria, one of the smallest in Italy, has this wonderful terrace looking onto Europe from Assisi, from St. Francis Terrace. And in Norcia, we have the terrace of St. Benedict. What has remained of this? Today, does the European continent have the moral strength to speak to the world as it has done for centuries? And the same can be said of Italy. The garden enclosed by mountains and sea, the cities and the cathedrals. Does this country, does Italy have the courage to rethink itself and to overcome that culture of excommunication and fragmentation to survive the logic of oligarchies and corporations? The process of globalization underway is so strong and so drastic, we cannot pretend there is nothing going on. We cannot take refuge in the past and the experience of witness. Otherwise, allow me the anecdote, we do like those widows who are folded over themselves, regretting the ancient nobility. So this is the first authentic challenge for Italian and European Catholicism, is to rediscover our history without making any discounts, and to discover our real presence in society, a real, authentic, visible presence in every public sphere, in every crevice of society, starting from those furthest away, the poorest, abandoned by all, outside the media circuits, ignored by the powerful and by the wise, because we are called not to be served, but to serve. And only in this way can we be authentic salt of the earth and yeast for society. And also for you, I am talking to the young people. I am old, I'm 72 years old. I don't have problems for my future, but I have serious problems for your future as young people. And in my own small way, I try to do everything I can as a bishop and as a cardinal for you. I did this with the University of Perugia, and I will continue to do so. Together, we must grasp this heritage, and from this point of view, the testimony of faith, which comes with strength from Latin America, invites us, obliges us to look at the world and our society and Italy from another standpoint, without moralism and over and above any doctrinal Manichaeism. We need to rediscover ourselves in the light of the gospel. We need to leave our comfort zone, which gratifies us, but which blocks us in our missionary action. A missionary action which stems from the words of Pope Francis, pronounced at the General Assembly of the Episcopal Conference in May, we must have three great objectives, three horizons, three great challenges: the family, work, and immigration. And here I need to make a choice, because if I read my entire talk, then I will go beyond the time allotted to me. My talk has been given to you. You can read it through. And I ask you to embrace these three challenges: the family, and immigration, and work. Because these are the three challenges which Pope Francis offered to the Assembly of the Italian Episcopal Conference. He gave us a task. He asked us to reflect on these three themes, which are so fundamental to man's life today. I would like to read through these, but I think there is not enough time. These three horizons, these three challenges, invest man directly, and as I've already had occasion to say almost a year ago during a meeting on these topics in Assisi, the desire of humanity to be rescued brings us to the existential peripheries and the suffering of living, in the hope that what is human, faced with the unstoppable arrest of technology, will return to the center point of reflection. On the other hand, science and technology have overcome frontiers and are opening horizons which were unimaginable in the sphere of bioethics and in the social sphere. Our trust in the intelligence and freedom of man is not incompatible, be careful. It is fed by the recognition that the irrenounceable values of every individual and every human existence is a limit that cannot and must not be overcome. I come from Florence. When I was a boy, I was often accompanied by our chancellor to La Pira. When I was rector there, I also invited him to talk to the seminarists, because he transmitted life and holiness. And I remember something he said that has always remained impressed on me. It doesn't have a scientific, but has a moral meaning. Reflecting on the atomic bomb, he said to the seminarists, "Have you seen what the splitting the atom caused in Hiroshima and in Nagasaki? Total destruction. And today we could add Chernobyl too." We hadn't got there yet, but he was a prophet. He said that when man will come to manipulate the fundamental laws of life, something even more terrible will happen. And we have reached this point. And then he said that God is a jealous God. He is jealous of the DNA which governs the intimacy of matter and the intimacy of life, because these are laws the Creator laid down, and on which and beyond which human progress cannot proceed. Referring to the north and the south of the world also means talking about war and peace, the new persecutions, and the great testimony of faith that many of our brothers have rendered to the whole world by paying with their own lives their encounter with Christ. This is a challenge I would like to launch to all of you, and I would like to say what a magnificent fault to have met Jesus in the Eucharist. It would be a wonderful thing if there were more faults like this. And in the globalization of indifference and the weakness of international institutions, wars proliferate with intolerable suffering, with violation of rights and religious persecution, hate that produces hate and that further sends off any solution. And in the lake of Tiberias that Lapira referred to, the Mediterranean, we have a series of peoples, but the peoples on the shores of a lake are neighbors. They could be rivals, but never enemies. They could be rivals because I am on one shore and the other is on the other shore. So that could be rivals, said Professor Lapira, but never enemies. And you can understand the profundity of what he was saying. And here I would like to talk further, but I will stop. The mission of the church is the pastoral conversion. To live in this setting, the evangelizing mission, dear friends, as Evangelii Gaudium suggested and suggests to us, the Holy Father Francis has introduced the church into a new phase of reform. The Vatican Council, the Second Vatican Council, returns with the focus of the periphery in this exhortation. The Pope came from the end of the world, bringing the peripheries to the center, as if there were a magnifying glass through which everyone can contemplate and be amazed by what the Lord has sown in the 50 years of the church since Vatican Council, the Second Vatican Council. The Lord made the church through the Second Vatican Council, through the lips of Pope Francis. This is called pastoral conversion. Pastoral conversion is not a reconciliation with the modern world, as some are inclined to think. It is something far more radical. At the same time, it is restoring to the church the serenity of being incarnate in history and the ability to speak the language of modern times in current ongoing change and flux. And I would like you to reflect on this. The pastoral conversion is something which is simply evangelical. The Pope Francis preaches the gospel, nothing more, nothing less. And what he said at Parasida, referring to the pastoral conversion, is that pastoral is the exercise of the role of the church. It generates, grows, and feeds, and accompanies by the hand. We need a church that is able to rediscover the bowels of mercy. Without mercy, there is nothing to be done today. To be part of a field hospital where what is required is pardon, understanding, and love. Mercy, as John the 23rd said in the Second Vatican Council. He said that mercy, the church must always understand the light of the gospel. There are those to whom it was sent. Each individual Christian community must enter a process of community in order to respond to the gospel in the setting in which they live. And for this reason, they also need to overcome so many forms of clericalism, which are rife even today. Talking about the gospel without bearing in mind what is seen and lived in the community in the light of the gospel and in a blind guide who have seen the gospel as a manual and do not know that it is the word of life that acts in the church and in the world. And lastly, the outskirts, the peripheries, starting from the meek from the infirm, from the abandoned. Today, Pope Francis said that the poor are those privileged by the gospel. The gospel is destined to them and to the kingdom that Jesus has come to bring us. After the 4th of October last year, the Pope came to Assisi, and the first meeting was in the Seraphic Institute with the handicapped and the disabled. He came half an hour early in order to meet them. Everyone was expecting the Pope to make a speech, but he embraced all the children who were there with tears in their eyes. Francis said, "The wounds of these children are the wounds of the flesh of Christ." And this is something that I think was worth more than an entire encyclical. To conclude, with two very simple expressions that Francis stated on his journey to the bishops of South Korea. And with these two expressions, I think they summarize what I've tried to say to you today. The Pope said to the bishops, build a versatile and creative church in announcing the gospel. And I say to young people, think big. Think far, because you, by looking far and scrutinizing the future, you will be able to indicate the road that we are to follow. We need to help you. We need to support you. As Cardinal Benelli said, you must not walk in front of them or behind them, because if you walk in front, they could trip over. If you walk behind, you don't see what is going on. You must walk beside them. We don't want to walk in front of you. We want, you are the future, and as a church, we want to walk alongside you. And I say, aim far, think big, do not stop. Do not stop in the small chicken hutches en route, which do not scratch around in the chicken hutches around us. Aim high, think big, look far. These are the sentinels of the future who can grasp the sign of the times and can who help you, as the adult generation, as the Pope said, to create a young, versatile, and creative church. Thank you. Thank you for your attention.
Ora devo dire che nel dare la parola al professor.
His Eminence in his talk spoke about the challenge that the Italian Church has and also the challenge that Europe has from Latin America. And this leads me to introduce Professor Carriquiry. He will start out from Evangelii Gaudium and will mention challenges also for Latin America. It will be interesting, therefore, to understand the link between Evangelii Gaudium and the challenges for Latin America. I'd like to welcome all the bishops here, and also on behalf of the Rimini meeting, I'd like to welcome Monsignor Warduni from Baghdad. He's been here for a few days already. His Eminence spoke about the testimonies. That's why I would like to mention this. Thank you very much, Professor Carriquiry. Thank you very much to all my friends at the Rimini meeting for this kind invitation. Yesterday, we were particularly impressed by Father Antonio Spadaro, who, following his encounter with Pope Francis and well-known interview, opened up so many windows on the fascinating reality of of today's Pope. And even Cardinal Bassetti made an enlightened speech. I would like to add a few notes on the effects of Pope Francis's exhortation to Latin America. The Bishop of Rome and Universal Pastor has unveiled unpredicted consequences for the entire Italian Catholic Church and Latin America. Pride, joy, enthusiasm that almost all Latin Americans feel are certainly good feelings, but they're not enough. What we need is also to become aware of the new needs, of the new responsibilities and new challenges that this event implies in a period of grace. Like this one, God's providence places the Church, the peoples and the nations of Latin America in quite a unique, exceptional situation. One could even state that one should reread history in the light of the current reality and future prospects of Latin America. In the light of this event, we cannot decrease the or narrow the horizon in which we find ourselves. And what we have clear in mind is the words by Benedict the 16th in the plane taking him to San Paolo Parecida. I'm convinced, he said, that here in Latin America, major decisions are made as to the future of the Catholic Church. It is not by chance that in spite of the decline in Europe, in Latin America, we have 40% of the Catholics in the world, to whom we should add dozens of millions of Hispanics living in the U.S. And within 5 years, they will be half the Catholics of that big nation. Brazil, Mexico, the Philippines, and the U.S. are the nations with the largest number of Catholics, followed by Italy and France. But within 15 years, they will be overcome by Colombia, the Democratic Republic of Congo, and Nigeria. Those that were regarded as peripheries once start having the largest number of Catholics. We can say that Latin America is the extreme west of certain peoples, the southern apex of the triangular west, which has its cradle in Europe and its apex at the level of the powerful United States. Latin America encompasses the European cultural heritage and the Catholic tradition, with the intermingling of new peoples. Now, Latin America is an emerging region carrying Catholic traditions. It's some kind of mediation among the overdeveloped areas which are experiencing crises and peripheral nations and peoples that are emerging, but they are no longer marginal, and they're changing the geopolitics and the economy worldwide. What does this emerging central role mean to Latin America within the Catholic world? The effect of Pope Francis is deep-rooted in Latin America. It's hard to put it in a framework. There is a current which is certainly supported by the media. Certain prejudices and resistances are broken. Some have a sense of restlessness in their soul with lots of questions and expectations. To others, Pope Francis is like going back home after having left home. But above all, this means re-flourishing of the Catholic faith. There are many individual conversions, many more individual conversions. There is less attendance to the masses in the churches, and there is also greater participation in pilgrimages to Mary's sanctuaries. There are more people confessing. Everybody shows the pride and joy to be Catholic. There is even greater attention by the public authorities to the presence of the Church, and the Church increases its credibility. However, we should ask ourselves several questions. Since the beginning of the Pope's office, I've always repeated a question. What is it that the Spirit of God says to the Church and the churches through the testimony and the teachings and ministry of the Pope? What is God pointing at? What is God telling us about? What is God showing us? All these questions are questions that Christian communities and we as individuals should ask ourselves. What is this bringing to your movement? Not as an add-on, but as a recovery, a re-flourishing of the charism in everybody's life, in the life of all of you, guided by Julian Caron. In order to find an answer to these questions, one should read and sort of digest the contents of the apostolic exhortation Evangelii Gaudium. Pope Francis would like us to use this document to approach and to get into a new step in spreading out the gospel with confident joy, following the road that he has pointed out for the path of the Church in the coming years. If one should summarize the greatest challenge which is currently found in Latin America now, one could state, together with Benedict the 17th in Brazil, that it is important to make a quality leap in terms of the people's faith. There should be a reconsecration of the religious communities in a church which is asked to encompass the great treasures of grace, sanctity, doctrine, culture, and mercy, which are the characteristics of the Catholic Church. The Church in Latin America is, thanks God, able to perform this difficult historical task by the grace of God? Are we at the eve of a Latin American Catholic Risorgimento? Well, everyone in Latin America, all of the 80% of those that are baptized in Latin America should feel directly involved by the words of Pope Francis when he, in his exhortation, says, "I invite all Christians, independently of the place and circumstances in which they live, to renew now their personal encounter with Jesus Christ, or at least make a decision to be encountered by Jesus Christ and look for him every day in an endless way." And this is an urgent invitation, an essential one, where all the words, initiatives, and gestures of the papal office of Pope Francis are concentrated. Also, when addressing the Italian bishops, Pope Francis asked himself, "Who is Jesus Christ to me? How has he shown the truth in my life and what does my life tell me about him. We cannot deny that the Catholic tradition is the largest treasure of our peoples, but for some time there has been a gradual deep erosion. Secularization is advancing everywhere, especially in large cities. Many millions of Catholics, baptized Catholics, have migrated towards evangelical communities or other sects. For many, baptism was concealed under indifference and neglect. The tradition of the Catholic faith is difficult to pursue even in Latin America. All of us who've been baptized are asked to start again from Christ. As John Paul II said, recognize his presence and follow him with the same astonishment, the same affection and persuasion which was found among the first disciples who met him 2,000 years ago, or with like the Juan Diegos of the New World 500 years ago. First of all, we need a personal conversion before answering any question. As Pope Francis repeats all the time, conversion is the gift of recognizing that you are a sinner, and you, as a beggar, give yourself to the grace of God in order to think like Christ, feel like Christ, and live like Christ. It's the regeneration of a multitude of baptized Catholics in whom there's still a great deal of faith, in whom faith fuels popular or people's religiosity. And really, we have to convert these people have to convert themselves into a people of disciples, testimonies, and missionaries of the Lord. Pope Francis, in the apostolic exhortation Evangelii Gaudium, also invites us to pastoral conversion, and Cardinal Bassetti mentioned this. Hoping that he is indulgent to me, I would like to add something as a humble pastor. You know, every pastoral conversion seems to start from the pastors, from the bishops and the clergy. If the Holy Father speaks of a reform which is ongoing already, this also means an episcopal reform. And Pope Francis mentioned this quite clearly in his meeting with the pontifical representatives, and also in his visit to the congregation of the bishops in Vatican. But the best example is the one that the Pope is setting to his brothers. It's just enough to look at the Pope and follow him, everyone according to his own temperament and circumstances, without trying to copy him, but simply driven by mercy, by charity towards all peoples. It would be too easy to meet this need for pastoral conversion by stating that one has always done what the Pope says and shows. If things were like this, it wouldn't have had any meaning to devote entire paragraphs to the exhortation towards or relating to certain temptations of the pastoral agents. You can't leave things as they are, as if nothing had happened. There's always something more that the Lord wants us to do. We need a conversion. Sometimes the Pope has been proposed as a person renewing things, while the Church has been presented as conservative and resistant by certain media. The pastoral reform also will also, well, on the best, the pastoral reform, also the multiplier effect of the reform process will depend. Pastoral conversion means that you turn from a conservative church to a missionary church. Pope Francis, as we heard, would like missionaries to be the paradigm of any action of the church. The new step in spreading out the gospel that Evangelii Gaudium refers to was officially opened by the Second Vatican Council and was also repeated in the apostolic exhortation Evangelii Nuntiandi by Paul the Sixth, and this was relaunched by an appeal to new evangelization by John Paul II and Benedict XVI. Nevertheless, in the current pontifical office, and especially in the apostolic exhortation Evangelii Gaudium, what we feel is renewed and urging dynamism of the church, a church that has to get out to the world and should not be restrained by certain fences. Going out is the verb most frequently used by Pope Francis. One has to go out towards the ends of existence and of the earth. Using empathy, as Father Spadaro said, and this empathy allows the gospel to be spread out from one person to the other, from one experience to the other. The papal office of Jorge Mario Bergoglio gives an entirely different strength and light to the already very important appeal of Aparecida for a continental mission, which is now a universal mission. However, continental mission should not be limited to ecclesial rhetorics. It should not be reduced to the simple implementation of programs, structures, and pastoral strategies. If evangelization proceeds and advances by attraction, because of a beauty which is splendid truth, as Benedict XVI said in Aparecida and as Pope Francis repeats, well, it is from them that you have to analyze your consciences, and this should be done by all Christian communities. We should ask ourselves to what extent we make Christ visible in our life circumstances beyond our limits, beyond our sins. How can we transfer the strength of resurrection, as the Pope says in his exhortation? How do we convey the beauty of the faith without reducing it to the idle repetition of doctrines and norms? How do we convey his truth without ideological contaminations? Going out and approaching people with a gaze which is full of mercy. And this is something you have to experiment firsthand. This is the great time of mercy. Don't forget this, the Pope says. This is the great time of mercy. And the very origin of the word mercy shows that there has to be a heart embracing the poor and those in need. It's the image of the father waiting for his son with open arms without considering his sons. It's the image of the Good Samaritan stopping in front of the wounded person and taking him to a shelter like a field hospital. And this is what Pope Francis has said about the church. We, in the streets of our Latin American cities, we see many people who are wounded in their bodies and souls. There are massacres caused by substance abuse and drug trafficking. Families are disrupted. There are abandoned children and elderly people. there is also human trafficking. Indigenous communities are marginalized and threatened, and children are very vulnerable, even in the mother's womb. It's no longer a matter of people who are oppressed and exploited, but it's a matter of new slaves and waste material. We live with them, and we drag their wounds behind us. In Latin America, the church is asked to bear witness to the preferential option, the priority option for poor people. And this is something which has always characterized the disciples and testimonies of a God who becomes as poor as possible and identifies himself especially with the poor, the diseased, and those that are left at the margins. In the teachings of the Church, there has never been such a theological development as that of the priority towards poor people as the one shown in the document of Aparecido and the exhortation Evangelii Gaudium. The daily gestures of Pope Francis set an example to what one is supposed to expect from the Christian communities, a poor church for poor people. I would have liked to speak of the priority that should be given to the families in Latin America and also priority of evangelization of young people after the major event of Copacabana, but I have to skip this for the sake of time, as His Eminence did. In dealing with the crisis of the family and the generational gap, certainly tradition and faith are at stake. Let me also add something. This new evangelization, which embraces our peoples, should overcome our ecclesial frontiers in Latin America. The fact that we have a Latin American Pope should awaken a universal attitude which should lead us to cooperate in an effective way with the universal mystery of the Pope. There are already many Latin American priests accompanying evangelization of Hispanics in the United States. Others cooperate for a re-flourishing of the gospel in arid areas of Europe. We need to pay the historical debt of the slaves, especially in Brazil, by cooperating with the African churches. We have forgotten that the first Latin American martyr was in Japan on the eve of evangelization of the New World, when the route from Mexico to the Philippines was uniting us in the common devotion to Our Lady of Guadalupe. There are brave missionaries of the Pacific Alliance, not just priests and religious people, but other people as well. Or is this science fiction? Does it sound like science fiction to us? Then there is a social and political dimension of the gospel that Pope Francis develops in Evangelii Gaudium, similarly to the Aparecida document. This culture of encounter proposed by the Pope, what is its meaning to Latin America? What does priority for poor people mean? What does commitment for solidarity, equity, and justice mean? What is it that the radical critique to the idolatry of power and richness means? And also defending the peace against any violence, what does this mean? We have to support the main pillars of any healthy cohabitation, like the family, the life, education, health, work, and security. How can we mobilize and reconstruct responsibilities and the freedom of people and peoples? How can we give dignity back to politics and move towards more mature democracies? How can we give new force to unity and integration so that we form a large Latin American country or homeland, as Pope Francis says? But what are the experiences to be proposed? Who are the subjects that should be involved in all this? There are major challenges in Latin America going beyond violence and ideologies, which have not found a sufficient answer yet. Even before the papal office of Pope Benedict XVI pointed to Christianity as to the most radical change in history, my friend Alberto Methol Ferre stated that following a failure, a historical failure in the revolutionary tradition against God and without God, it was only the church that could take the language of revolution again with some credibility. I don't know whether in those days Jorge Margo Bergoglio was reading these statements. As Pope Francis, Bergoglio asks us to be testimonies and protagonists of a revolution of love, a revolution of faith, grace. Certainly this is the most revolutionary of all revolutions because it radically changes people and infuses a great deal of love and truth, as well as solidarity and fraternity in people's lives. Pope Francis has started an evangelical revolution, the largest revolution of all. And he has shown us that the gospel is the best answer to the thirst for equity and justice, which has always been there in the Latin American peoples. Perhaps we are at the beginning of a new ecclesial Latin American spring. We are in an historical, we have a historical opportunity that we cannot waste. God has put us in front of difficult, huge challenges, but we have to pray for His grace, and Her Lady of Guadalupe will certainly provide us with all this grace. Thank you.
Cosa ci sta chiedendo il Signore?
What is the Lord asking us? What roads is He showing to us? As Professor Carriquiry asked at the beginning of his talk, one road is to look into the distance, to think big. One of the last expressions of the talk by Cardinal Bassetti. And with these words, I would like to thank you for the future perspectives that have been shown to us today. I would like to thank our guests for their patience and for being with us at the meeting today. Cardinal Professor Guzmán has been here for several days and will spend the afternoon with us as well. I'd like to thank all of you and just ask you for a few minutes more patience, because this meeting was made possible by the collaboration which the meeting has had in the last few years with the Italian Episcopal Conference for its cultural projects. And I see here the executive members responsible for this project, and I'd like to thank them for their assistance and their collaboration. Every year, this collaboration produces some interesting results for our meeting, and this allows me to recall that this year, underway at the meeting, is an initiative called Community Meeting, and this is a proposal to support and participate in with an active role in supporting the meeting, which, as you all know, has changed over the years with a serious shortage of resources. So our work year after year to look into the future and to think big, which is the aim of the meeting, obviously increasingly requires your participation and contribution. The community meeting can be contacted, and more can be understood about the proposal of the community meeting in two stands in Hall C3. Throughout the year, we enter into the reality of the meeting and offer the possibility of being involved in the organization of the meeting and also a contribution by everyone who takes part. So thank you again for your attention, and I wish you a successful meeting.